We're glad you're visiting with us this morning. Glad you came to worship with us. It's a special day for us. We've got Brother Mike Goodrich coming this morning in view of a call as our music minister. So we'll be having a short, brief meeting, very brief meeting after church services this morning to call him as our music minister. Also, we've got Brentley Anthony being baptized this morning. So if you would, bow with me for a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we rejoice this morning in your goodness and your mercy and your grace. We thank you for your abiding love. Lord, we pray that you'll make this moment very special to Brentley, that you would impress upon her your nearness, your love to her. Father, we pray for the rest of the congregation that our hearts will be moved today and drawn into a closer walk with you. We pray for Brother Mike as he leads us in worship. Bless him and use him for your honor and glory. And it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Well, good morning, everybody. It is sure good to be in God's house today. I just want you to remember one thing as we get started this morning. That a song has the ability to change your day, but God has the ability to change your life. And I also find it really important to say that I don't stand up here to impress anybody, but rather follow in the calling that God has laid out over my life. I hope as we go to the Lord today that you can just have an intimate relationship with Him through worship and listen to what it is that He's telling you today, so that when Brother Brandon gets up here to deliver that word, you can hear that word. And it can speak to you the way that Jesus intends that to be done today. Amen. If you feel called to stand while you worship, please do so. If you want to sit, that's okay too. Worship the way you want. Don't worry about the person next to you, because it's definitely not about them.
Nothing worth more that could ever come close. Nothing can compare. You are living hope. Your presence. And I've tasted and seen. So love, when my heart becomes free, the shame is undone. Your presence,
Holy Spirit, you are welcome.
To be over. There's nothing worth more that could ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're all that we hold. Your presence. And I've tasted and seen the sweetest of loves, when my heart becomes free and the shame is undone. Your presence, Holy Spirit, you are welcome. Come and through the atmosphere, your glory, God, is what our hearts long to be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord.
Let us become.
Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Your presence, Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. And flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long to be. Your presence,
good morning again. The only thing I really want to announce is tonight we're having ice cream supper. Yeah, that's a glory. Do want you to pay attention to our different activities going on this week. Also, jail ministry is not on here, but we have jail ministry today at 1:30. And I'm still looking for volunteers for people who want to minister in the jail, especially men. We've got several women, but we need more men. Is there anything else that we need to announce today? Whenever he finishes singing. Any other announcements? Any other questions? Bow with me for a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, again, we ask that you would bless our time together this morning, that you would be with us, that you would call and pull on our hearts. Lord, that we'd be drawn into a closer fellowship and walk with you. We ask that you bless our time together, and it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Brother Mike.
Sir, kiddos, y'all come on up, please. All the kiddos, or if you feel like you're a kiddo. Good morning. Guys, I'm going to need y'all to help me just a little bit. Okay, if you would take one and pass them around, and y'all take one, pass the rest of them around, and y'all take one, pass the rest of them around. Okay? Everybody gets one. While y'all getting a card, I'm going to ask you a question. Does anybody here know what this is? A crayon. What do you do with a crayon? You color with it? Is that all you can do with it? Not really? You can do other things, can't you? You can write, can't you? You can draw, right? Okay. I'm going to give each one of you a crayon. And then while I talk a little bit, I'm going to give you just a few seconds, about 30 seconds, okay? And I want you to make a mark. Here comes two more. Come on. Come on, sit down right here. Both of y'all. Come on. There you go. Huh? Well, we'll see how it turns out. It's going to turn out great, I can tell you. So anyway, I'm going to give you a crayon, and then I'm going to let you, if you would, either to write on that card, write your name, draw a picture or a cow, a horse, do ABCs, just do something on that card, okay? Huh? Make a mark. Yeah, make a mark. So I'm going to give each one of you a crayon, okay? And then when I get through, then I need you to give me the crayons back. So here's the crayons, okay? Everybody get one. Can't pick which color? Any color works just fine. And what a wonderful group. I want y'all to notice something about our children here. And they deviated from my plan. Everyone got one? That is really no good. Okay, now that's my plan.
I can't really see it that good. There's so much I can't pick.
Well, pick one, because we got to move on. Everybody got one? All right, everybody got one? You got one, sweetie? She didn't.
I can't find any.
That's all right. Well, I was afraid that y'all would say, these are not very good.
Yeah.
Yeah. But y'all didn't say that. You, huh? Not working right. Okay, that's close enough. Here goes, sweetie. Yeah, right on it. Okay? Put a mark on there. Okay, I sure will in a minute. Okay. If y'all want to follow along with me, I'm going to be going in Exodus chapter 4. Verse 12, and it says, now go, and I will help you speak and teach you what to say. Now go, and I will help you speak, and I will teach you what to say. For a lot of people in the world, we are the only Bible that they ever read. Now think about that for a minute. We are the only Bible some people ever see and read, okay? And it doesn't matter if you're 3 or 103, you can be loving and you can be kind. Now, the Crayolas I gave you were different sizes. They were different colors. Some of them were sharp. Some of them were dull.
None of them were sharp.
There you go. Now you're getting into it. None of them were very sharp. A lot of them were dull. And if you had a little more wrapper around them, they have names on them, and they're very strange-sounding names. Some of them are fairly new, and a lot of them are really, really old, okay? But you know, as I look at these crayons, we can learn a whole lot about these crayons. Doesn't matter what color, what shape, whether they have a wrapper or no wrapper or whatever, they all fit in this box very nicely, don't they? And this is a good representation of church, us as people. We're one body. We fit nicely into this building because of Jesus Christ and what he's done for us. That's what allows us to fit nicely into a box. And we don't have to be brightly colored. Y'all can put all these other ones in here, okay? If you will, just drop them in here. Hold up your drawings to the people out in front where they can see what you drew, okay? Everybody, some of them got drawings, some of them just got a mark, one single line. Some of them got pictures, okay? And that's a good representation of us because we can do a lot for people, okay? And as I've already said, we're the only Bible a lot of people is going to read, okay? So we must always be ready and quick to give a good answer about Jesus Christ, just like the young lady did a while ago that got baptized. Jesus Christ is her Lord and Savior. And that's what I hope all of us can say. If we can't say it now, in the future, hopefully you'll be able to say it, okay? Yeah, that's cute, sweetie. That's really cute. All right, so everybody got the old crayons back in here? No? Okay, put your old crayons back in here. And like I said, they're all broken up and chopped up and every color in the world. They're better than that. Well, let me see if I can make your day better, okay? I just happen to have in this bag some new Crayolas. Now, I want you younger kids to get these boxes of Crayolas, okay? So if you're like 5 years old or younger, okay, you're three, you qualify. Come on, if you're 5 or 6 years of age, come on and get you a new box of Crayolas. Huh? You're seven? All right. You're three, you get a box. Who else is? You're four, okay. You're four. Whew, I hope that's the last four. You're four? Okay, we'll open it in a minute. Now, you older kids, y'all going to get map colors. Okay? Y'all going to get map colors. Okay? Now, I want you to use the map colors, use the crayons, mark on your paper. Okay? But as you mark, you think about what kind of mark are you making for Jesus Christ. Okay? That's the main thing. All right, has everybody got one? Everybody gets one. Come on, sweetie. Everybody got one? Okay. All right. Y'all been great listeners. Isn't it great to see all these kids up here? Woo! This is a blessing. This is a blessing. All right. Let's pray. And then y'all going to go see Brother Tracy. And he's got a life saver. And Jesus Christ is our life saver. Okay. Don't ever forget that. Let's pray. God, thank you for the children. I ask that you bless their lives. And as they get ready to inner school, let them be a positive influence on someone else, Lord. Thank you for the homes they come from the families that love them enough to bring them to church, to introduce them to Jesus Christ. Forgive us where we fail, Lord, and be merciful to us, we ask in Christ's name. Amen. All right, y'all go see Brother Trace, and he'll give you some candy, and what do you say? You make sure you say thank you to Brother Trace. Is this your box, sweetie? This is yours. All those are yours. Get your cards here. Somebody left their cards. You already have one? Okay.
Let's do a little more worshiping together this morning.
When I was young, you called my name. I tried to run, but still you came. You stepped into the dark. That's just the kind of God you are. Heaven seems beyond my reach. You still see eternity in me. You're turning ashes into art. That's just the kind of God you are. Sing the empty tomb. It's on the rugged cross. You dead defying love. It's written in your scars. You never quit on me. You'll always hold my heart. That's the kind of God you are. You gave me freedom from my sin. You told me I could walk again. Oh, the hurt is dead and gone. Now we're your daughters and your sons. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound. We once were lost, but now we're found. Forever you hold us in your arms. That's just the kind of God you are. It's in the empty tomb. It's on the rugged cross. Your death-defying love is written in your scars. You'll never quit on me. You'll always hold my heart. That's the kind of God you are. You are holy, holy, holy. High set apart. You are holy. Still you came. You stepped into the dark. That's just the kind of God you are.
Amen.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. He's been my fourth man in the fire, time after time. Born of his spirit, washed in his blood. And what he did for me on Calvary's more than enough. And And I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. I trust in God, my Savior. Perfect submission, and all is at rest. And I know the author of tomorrow's ordered my steps. This is my story, this is my song. Praising my risen King and Savior all the day long. And I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. I saw the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. I saw the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. I saw the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. That's why I trust in, that's why I trust in. I saw the Lord, then he heard, then he answered. I saw the Lord, then he heard, then he answered. I saw the Lord, then he heard, then he answered. That's why I trust in, that's why I trust in God. The splendor of a king, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide. Trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And oh, see how great is our God. Time is in his hands, beginning and the end, beginning and the end. the Godhead three in one. Father, Spirit, Son, the Lion and the Lamb, the Lion and the Lamb. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And so we'll see how great is our God. Name above all names. Sings my soul.
Well, good morning. Again, I pray that you have been blessed this morning. I know
that I have throughout the entirety of this worship service. If you have your Bibles, go ahead and open them to the book of 1 John. We're continuing our verse-by-verse study of the epistle of 1 John. What I would like to do before we pray this morning, if you are a note taker, even if you're not, I want to encourage you. I saw some of your heads pop up when I said note taker. Where are my note takers and my list makers at in here? Okay, all right, there's lots of you. Okay, good. All right. If you are a note taker, if you are a list maker, this is for you. If you are like me and don't like taking notes or don't like taking or making lists, I'm going to encourage you to do it anyways, all right? It's a real simple list I'm going to ask you to make this morning before we pray, all right? So you can take out your phone, notes on your phone, write down a list, whatever it is. I want y'all to be able to physically see this and understand kind of where we're going when we get to the end today. All right, so here's the list that I want you to make. First thing you're going to write down is the people that you live with, all right? Now, if you're here, you live by yourself, that's all right. I just want you to write down the names of the people who live closest to you, all right? So you can write down names of the people that you live with, write down the names of the people who live closest to you, all right? That's the first thing. All right, after that, I want you to write down your place of employment. All right, if you're in here, you don't have a job, that's okay. Or if you're retired, I saw some happy faces pop up of people that I know are retired. All right, that's all right. You can write down, the other thing that I want you to write down is write down the places that you frequent the most. All right, so I don't know, Brookshire's, gas station that you go to regularly, restaurant that you enjoy eating at a lot, whatever it may be. All right, the places that you frequent the most. All right, gym, golf course, whatever it is, all right? So once you have those, that's your list, all right? Hang on to that list, we'll get back to it, all right? So let's open up with a word of prayer, and then we'll get going. Father, we thank you for this day, Lord. We thank you for all the ways that you love and bless us today. God, we pray for this time, Lord, that you would anoint it, that, Father, that you would speak to me and through me this morning, Lord. Father, we pray that as we look into your word, Lord, that it would become real and relevant to us. Speak to us this morning. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right. So if you know me, you know that I love going to the movies. I am a big movie buff. It has just been something I have done my entire life. I love doing it. Now, if you ever go to a movie with me for whatever reason, you got to know that I take this serious. All right. Now, I like going to the movies, but I'm very serious about going to the movies. Now, I don't just like to randomly go see a movie on a Tuesday or whatever. I like to go to the premiere of a movie because I have heard nothing gets spoiled. And not only that, I'm in the environment of people who are radical and crazy just like me, right, who want to go see because it's an environment thing too. Now, we recently took our boys to see their first movie. It was an awesome experience. We saw Despicable Me 4. All right, I have learned that the Minions, that is my boys' type of humor, right? Like that is what they laugh at. So we took them to see Despicable Me 4. Now, I had to make them understand a few things about going to the movies with Daddy. All right, we're not late when we go to the movies with Daddy. I have a big problem about being late places, all right? I'm not late to a movie, all right? Because, I want to know why I'm not late to a movie. There's something I want to see. What is it? The previews. All right. How many people, if you go to the movie, you got to see the previews? No, what? I do not miss. Like, listen, if I get to the movies and I have not got my tickets yet, I will get a later time. I will wait 30 minutes or more just to see the trailers. Like, I love seeing the trailers. All right. I am big time into watching the trailers. If I don't see the trailers, if I walk in and it's like, welcome to Cinemark Theater or whatever, and I know that all the trailers have passed, it like ruins the experience for me. I just don't like it. I have to see the trailers. I love trailers. What a trailer is a trailer is a glimpse of the main feature, right? A trailer is a glimpse of the main feature. It's supposed to make you yearn to want to see the main feature, right? It's not the main feature. It's a glimpse of it, and it's supposed to make you yearn to want to see the main feature. And why I tell you that this morning is that is your role as a follower of Christ. You are not the main feature. Hate to break it to you, right? But you are not the main character in your story. I am sorry. All right? The main character is God. All right? He is the main character. This book that we read, it's about him, not about you. All right? God is the main character. You are meant to be a trailer. You're meant to give people a glimpse of what he is like and make people want to yearn to meet him, to see him. Your life is a trailer for God. And we're going to look at this morning, how do we do this? How is this possible? We're going to look at three things this morning about how we become a trailer for God, a preview for God. Number one is that you have to experience the love of God. Number two, you have to understand how God loves, because love is a term that is thrown around and especially thrown around in our society. We got to define it. And lastly, as a result of that, is that you show God's love. You show God's love. All right, so if you got your Bibles, 1 John chapter 4, we're going to start in verse 7. It says this, "Beloved, let us love one another, for love is from God. And whoever has been born of God and knows God, and whoever loves has been born of God and knows God. Anyone who does not love does not know God, because God is love." All right, so John, first thing, John gives some very bold claims in this passage, saying that if you do not show love, that basically you do not know God. This word "know" is the Greek word gnosko. All right, try saying that three times fast. It's a fun word. All right, gnosko, it is experiential love. Is that it means to know God's love is to experience God's love. That's the first thing this morning about how we become a trailer, is that you have to experience God's love. Now, I've mentioned this before, I want to mention it again. On my phone are several apps. All right, one app that I have that I deleted and I was very glad to delete was the weather app. All right, the weather app got on my nerves because I would know I need to mow, I would look at the weather app and it would be clear all day. And I would be like, okay, I'm good for a little bit. And I would go do something, and I would walk back out, and it's pouring down rain. I'm like, where did that come from? And I go back to the weather app, and sure enough, rain all day. I'm like, how do you get to just change that like that? So the weather app was just wrong for me all the time, the standard one, so I deleted it. And I started looking for better weather apps. And that is when I found Weather Kitty. All right? There he is right there. That's the hardest little working cat I've ever seen. All right? Let me tell you something about this cat. All right? This Weather Kitty app. Like, I tell everybody about this app. I tell everybody you need to delete the weather app and get Weather Kitty, because Weather Kitty has not steered me wrong. All right? Weather Kitty has a 7-day forecast. He has a 24-hour. He has a radar. All right, he will tell you the precipitation, the wind, what the moon is going to do. Like, Weather Kitty is awesome. All right, so if you're in need of a weather app, Weather Kitty. But why I tell you that and why I can speak on that is because I have experienced the app, is because I have used the app. If you're going to show love, you have to experience what true love is. And true love is only found in God. It says that God is love. You have to identify what that is. God is love. You have to experience the love of God. And I remember for the first time in my life when I was 17 years old, when I experienced God's love for the first time, radically got a hold of my life. And listen, I was a mess then. I'm still a mess now, but I'm his mess. God radically changed my life, and I heard about the love of God. And listen, it has been a journey, to say the least, the last 20 years. But as I look at my life and what I've gone through for the last 20 years of experiencing the love of God, of me and Brittany walking through 4 years of infertility, of watching my father-in-law battle cancer, of losing a child, I have seen and experienced the love of God over those last 20 years in ways that I never thought was possible. And any time that I have been tempted to run back to my old masters that I had before I first experienced the love of God, to run back to them, God has been gracious enough to wrap me in His arms and let me know that He still loves me, that He still has me. And I can sit here and I can testify this morning before you of the goodness and of the love of God because I have experienced it. So you have to experience it. If you're going to show the love of God, you have to experience the love of God. Then we've got to define it because you've got to understand how God loves. To be able to love like God loves, you've got to understand how God loves us. It says in verse 9, in this, the love of God was made manifest among us, that God sent His only Son into the world so that we might live through Him. In this is love, not that we have loved God, but that He loved us and sent His Son to be the propitiation for our sins. A term that's been thrown back on Christians a lot is, comes from this passage, that God is love. That people will say, oh, you can't judge me. God, you claim to be a Christian. God is love. God loves everybody. What they're really saying is not God is love, is that love is God. Is what they believe, is that love is God. And the world's definition of love is wrapped up in this form of acceptance and approval. And if I do something, whether you disagree with it or not, you still have to approve. And approval is pictured as love. That is not love. That is not love. Dave Raymond's over there. All right, and he just ducked down. But me and Dave works out a lot. Dave is a lot stronger than me. If Dave saw me going to pick up some weight off the bar that he can lift, but I can't, that's about to crush me, all right, for him to just sit there and look at me and be like, well, I can't tell him different. I'm just going to love him anyways and let him do what he wants to do, right? That's not loving. To love me would be to stop me before I make the stupid decision. That's loving. All right? So we got to understand what love actually is. And the Bible says that God is love. Listen, God is love. And the Bible is clear that God is just, that God is holy, that God is righteous. And all of this forms who God is. You can't separate God's love from His justice. You can't separate God's justice from His love. They're one and the same. So how was the love of God manifested? It was manifest. It says it was made apparent to us through Jesus Christ. That this is how God loves. And now, I love this. It says, not that we love God, but that He loved us. One of my favorite parts about being a pastor is getting to work with married couples. And a fun question I like to ask married couples all the time is, who liked who first, right? Like, who started the pursuit, right? Like, Brother Tracy, you and Claire, who liked who first? She did. Okay, all right. She's not in here, is she? Okay, all right. Where's Richie and Whitney? Who liked who first? You liked her first. Okay. All right. David, Carolyn, who liked you first? Yeah. I can tell you that in mine and Brittany's relationship, and she's shaking her head, we were having a conversation on the phone one night, and for some reason we were talking about our perfect spouse and stuff, and I had this, like, epiphany-type moment that everything that I was describing was her. But what I didn't realize was she had a crush on me for like 3 months before, right? So, but listen, we don't have to wonder that with God. We did not make the first move. God came to us. God came to us first. It's not that we love God. It was not that there was anything good in us. It was that there was nothing but good in God, and He came after us. You never have to question. God came after us first. And it says that Jesus, He sent His Son Jesus, that God in the flesh, Emmanuel, God with us, became the propitiation. Big word, right? It just simply means a sacrifice that turns away wrath. That Jesus became the once and all sacrifice for us is that because of our sins, that we were enemies of God. And because of that, do nothing but God's wrath. And God would have been completely justified to leave us in that state and do nothing about it. But because God is love, He sent His Son Jesus to live the life we couldn't. He died the death that we deserve, and He rose again victorious on the third day over death, hell, and the grave, that whoever puts their faith and their trust in Him will not perish, but will have eternal life. And life to the fullest now. He bore the full weight of God's wrath on our behalf so that we would never have to. It's all about what He did, not about what we did. I was very blessed and privileged enough this last year. I have been a lifetime suffering Dallas Cowboy fan. For better or for worse, Carol, are you with me? All right. And, I'm old enough to actually remember watching them win Super Bowls. It was a simpler time then. But I was privileged enough this last year. Somebody was very, very, very kind and loving and bought me and Ricky Waller, who's a pastor of FBC Cossey, tickets to go to a Cowboys game. And so this last year we went to the Cowboys game to watch the Cowboys play the Lions. The Favors family was there. We were actually sitting kind of close to each other. That was really fun. If you're a Cowboys fan and you remember this game was crazy. It looked like for the game, it was just back and forth the whole game, and it came down to like the last 10 seconds of the game, and it looked like the Lions had stolen victory from the Cowboys, and then this random flag came out, and the Lions had an illegal man downfield, and the Cowboys ended up holding them on their two-point conversion and won the game, and it was awesome, and we celebrated, and we screamed, and we went nuts in the stadiums, and we were walking down after the game, and it'd get quiet, and somebody would go, "Here we go," or "Go Cowboys," and we'd shout again. Listen, I got into that game because somebody paid me away. Somebody paid for my tickets. It's the only reason I was there. I was celebrating a victory at that game that I had nothing to do with. No part of them Cowboys winning that game was on me. One day, I'm going to breathe my last breath, and I'm going to stand before God. And strictly based upon what He has done, I'm going to hear, "Well done, good and faithful servant." And I'm going to enter into eternity. And for eternity, I'm going to celebrate a victory that I had nothing to do with because of what Jesus did on the cross. It's how God loves. Loves sacrificially. Loves without condition. This is the love of God and what He gave for us. So how do we become a trailer? You have to experience God's love. You got to understand how God loves. And lastly, just real quick, you got to show this type of love to the world. Is that this is the type of love that you show to the world. Real quick, verse 11 and 12. "Beloved, if God so loved us, then we ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God. If we love one another, God abides in us and His love is perfected in us. This is how people see God." It says that no one has seen God. No one has seen God the Father. It's that you have in the Old Testament what we call theophanies. It's God appearing in forms through visions, or through the burning bush, or whatever it is, physically manifesting Himself so His people could grasp Him. But we serve a God who is beyond our grasp, that we cannot fully understand or comprehend. So how does the world see Him? The world now sees Him through us in the way that we love, that we become the trailers. Listen. Jesus says, "By this, the whole world will know that you're my disciples." By the way, what? You love one another. It says that no one has seen God. But if we love one another, God abides in us and His love is perfected in us. I had you write down when you came in. People that you lived with. People that were your neighbors. Places that you frequent a lot, places you work. Listen, that's your audience. You want to know who? I wanted to give you some practical steps when you left here today. In case you were wondering about who you show the love of God to, start by looking at that paper. people that you live with, the people that you live by, the places that you frequent the most, place you work. And yes, even that coworker you can't stand. That's who you show the love of God to. I heard a story, we'll end with this. I heard a story this last week. Very practical way that this plays out. I heard a story this last week. This pastor was interviewing this man. This man was a former Muslim who had converted to Christianity. And he was asking him about his experience. How did he convert to Christianity? What was that experience like? He said, well, me and my family moved here a few generations back. And my dad started a business. He was a former Iranian military. He came over here and he decided that he was going to live that military life behind and that he was going to open a restaurant. And so he opened a restaurant. He said that one Sunday morning, he had to let a worker go. And so he was really short-staffed. He said Sunday came and was the lunch rush, and this church choir came to his restaurant. He said, this church choir came to his restaurant. He said, I got lunch rushed. They were short-staffed. They got so behind. Plates were backed up. They were struggling to keep people's drinks refilled and all this kind of stuff. And I don't know about you, if you have ever been in that situation where a restaurant is functioning like that and how you respond. I can't say that I have always responded perfectly in that situation. I want to repent of that. But I love what this church choir did in this moment. This church choir, knowing what was going on, kind of seeing what was happening, instead of sitting there complaining or getting up and leave, they simply got up and started waiting on tables. And they started bringing food from the kitchen to tables and refilling people's drinks. And so they did this during the entire lunch rush. And that was a Sunday. Then they decided they'd come back on Monday during the lunch hours and did the exact same thing. And that day they invited this guy's dad, who was a restaurant owner, to come to their choir practice. And he said, being a Muslim, he would have never stepped foot in a church, but because of the kindness that they had shown him, he went to this practice. And he said it was at this practice, this worship pastor by the name of Aubrey Edwards got everybody's attention and said, listen, this man needs help. He said, for the next 2 weeks, we need at least two people in there during every lunch hour to help this man out. He said, by just a few minutes, everybody in the choir had volunteered, and they got schedules figured out. And so for the next 2 weeks, this church choir just showed up at this man's restaurant and for free volunteered, helped serve tables, helped wait until he was able to hire and get back on his feet. And this guy who was telling the story, he said, I was just a little kid when this was happening, but I remember it so vividly. He said, within about 2 or 3 months of this happening, he said, my entire family came to know Jesus as their Savior. He said, this didn't happen because we walked into this amazing worship service. It was because somebody brought church to us. That these people came and showed us the love of God, this radical love of God we had never experienced before. And we wanted to know this Savior they kept demonstrating. Listen, that is how you show the love of God. That is how you are a trailer for the main feature. How do we do this? You got to experience God's love. You can't show anything that you have not experienced yourself. You got to understand how he loves, sacrificially without condition. And you got to go out into the world and you got to show this type of love with everybody that you meet. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for this day, Lord. We thank you for all the ways that you love and bless us today. Father, we pray for this time, Lord. Father, I pray for each and every believer in here today. God, I pray they would experience your love on a daily basis. Lord, they would recognize and understand how you love. And that, Father, where they go, they would show this love to the world. By this, all people will know that you are my followers by the way that you love one another. May we love people sacrificially, without condition, Lord, radically. Father, I pray for anybody in here who has never experienced the type of love that we are talking about. Father, may they surrender their lives to you today and come to know you. Lord, we love you, we thank you, and we praise you. It's in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. If you're here today...